Good morning, everyone. Today we are going to discuss the topic endometrial hyperplasia. But before starting the topic, let me revise 4 or 5 slides of leiomyoma. Well, as we discussed myomectomy in the last lecture, I have to emphasize here that for myomectomy, we take the classification as FIGO. For hysteroscopy, we take the classification as European. So type 0 is entirely within the myometrial cavity, endometrial cavity, and type 2 is myomectomy part, we take the classification as FIGO. And for hysteroscopy, we take the European classification for type 0, which is entirely within the endometrial cavity and no myometrial involvement, that is, it is a pedunculated fibroid. And type 1 is sessile, that is, with the 50%, less than 50% myometrial extension, and with type 2, that is sessile with more than 50% myometrial extension. So we, for hysteroscopy, we follow this classification. Okay. Now, just to revise, the type 0 myomas, that is, which are pedunculated and lying within the cavity, what is the treatment of choice? The treatment of choice is hysteroscopic myomectomy. That is, cutting the pedicle by hysteroscopy is indicated. For type 1 myoma, that is those myoma which are intracavitary, but they are extending into the myometrium, less than 50% extension is type 1. More than 50% extension is type 2. So we are talking about type 1, that is this type of myoma with most of the myoma extending into the uterine cavity, and it is sessile, that is not pedunculated. For that, the treatment of choice is, if it is less than 3 centimeters, you do a hysteroscopic myomectomy. And if it is more than 3 centimeter and the patient has anemia, then correct the anemia by medical therapy, give her sperms and GnRHa. And if no further treatment is required, that is, it has a good response. And if it doesn't respond to medical and sperms and GnRH, you do a hysteroscopic myomectomy. That is for type 1. For type 2 leiomyoma, that is still projecting into the intracavitary, but more than 50% is within the myometrium, what you do is medical therapy given for 2 courses or 3 months. Vast majority of these type 1 myomas would respond to this preoperative therapy and regress in size, so that you can do a good hysteroscopic myomectomy. It also gives you time to recover the hemoglobin of the patient, and sometimes the myomas regress as much as that they can be, no surgery is required for them. That is the treatment for type 2 myoma. Coming to type 2 or type 2 onwards up to 5, which may be single or multiple, but they are distorting the uterine cavity, you will divide it into 2 sections. Those with a reproductive age group and they desire fertility, that is young infertile women of reproductive age group, and it is a wish to conceive, then in those cases you start away with medical therapy. They often respond to this preoperative therapy and regress in size, and this reduction allows a hysteroscopic approach later and gives you time to correct the hemoglobin, and surgery may or may not be required depending upon the progress. And if the myomas are multiple or of different types, that is type 2, type 5, anything in between, it is frequently observed that medical therapy can be given for 2 courses of 3 months, and then there can be 3 possible responses. So in this case, we are dealing with reproductive age group or with type 2 myoma or multiple myoma, those who desire pregnancy and those who do not desire pregnancy. Those who desire pregnancy, what you are giving is 2 courses of 3 months of uliprestil acetate or sperms. If there is a very good response, that is what you call as very good is where the volume of reduction of that myoma is more than 50% and the cavity gets corrected, the cavity is restored to normal, then she may try the natural conception. If it is good response, that is only 25 to 50% correction and the bleeding is controlled, then also she can try natural conception. If the cavity remains distorted, then you can give give the hysteroscopic myomectomy can be done. And if it is insufficient response, then in that case you will resort to surgical methods. Then comes the reproductive age group of type 2 to type 5 myomas, but they do not desire pregnancy. This treatment is more or less similar to those with the postmenopausal or perimenopausal women and reproductive age women who do not desire pregnancy. That is, you give a long-term intermittent course, 4 courses of 3 months, and you see for the response. If it is insufficient, then you do for surgical myomectomy. If it is sufficient, good response, then stop treatment and follow up the patient for recurrence of symptoms. So this we discussed, what was in the left panel of the diagram and what was on the right panel of the diagram. This also we discussed, the same as reproductive age group which do not desire pregnancy is also the same as those with a premenopausal woman with type of myomas, where 4 courses of 3 months is given. Now a few slides of unusual fibroids. What is diffuse leiomyomatosis? It is a rare condition that consists of diffuse involvement of the myometrium. You can see the diffuse involvement of myometrium by innumerable small number of fibroids, which results in symmetrical enlargement of the uterus. Although histologically benign, they may be disseminated through the peritoneal cavity or occasionally metastasis to distant organs. The lipoleomyomas are another variety where those fibroids contain a lot of fat. The prevalence is less, very less than 0.2%. They are of course benign. The symptoms are as any other uterine fibroid. Most likely it is the fatty metamorphosis of the smooth muscle cells. They can be subserous pedunculated. In that case, they will be mistaken for ovarian dermoids. Sonography, the echogenicity matters because they are typically echogenic in contrast to hypoechoic of the regular fibroids. MRI has its differences, and a fat suppression technique may be useful to confirm the presence of fat. So those are lipoleomyomas. What about leiomyosarcomas? Leiomyosarcomas are also rare, and you can see this is the benign leiomyoma with a typical world appearance. It is non-invasive, non-metastatic, it is well differentiated, well demarcated, while the malignant leiomyosarcoma has a different histological picture, and it is locally malignant or locally metastatic. Recurrence after removal is common in these cancers, and they may metastasize locally or they can be spread to lungs, liver, bone and brain, with a 5-year survival of up to 40%. Outlook with anaplastic tumors is less favorable than the well-differentiated tumors. So leiomyosarcomas, though rare, found in 1 in 500, but are very aggressive and very fast-growing. They form about only 5 to 10% of the soft tissue sarcomas, that is to state that they are rare. Average age at diagnosis is about 50 to 51 years. And once diagnosed and treated by hysterectomy and chemo and radio, the 5-year survival rate is good, that is 40%. Now, 2 slides on the recommendation and guidelines of what we discussed about leiomyoma. So, in the last few classes, we learned that for leiomyoma, what are the guidelines are? We follow the FIGO guidelines, that is Federation of International Societies, and European guidelines for hysteroscopy. Then we found out that progesterone also has a role in pathophysiology. Not only estrogen, but progesterone also has a role, and therefore we have sperms. Then the first line of imaging is pelvic ultrasonography, the transvaginal or transabdominal approach. Then treatment is individualized, that is you can give treatment according to the age of the patient, whether she desires fertility, whether she has abnormal uterine bleeding. Of course, it would depend upon the availability of resources and the experience of the surgeon. We also knew that most of them are asymptomatic, and only thing which is required is reassurance. You have to wait and watch. No major concerns for malignancy. You have to assure them. Hysterectomy is definitely the first line of treatment if the patient doesn't desire fertility. Hysteroscopic is the first line of treatment if it is intracavitary leiomyoma. Another point in recommendation and guideline is that ulipristal acetate has come into picture. It can be used, but GnRH are avoided and not to use as the loss of planes are there, we saw, and of course bone mineral density is affected. Aromatase inhibitors, though, can be used. There is insufficient data. Whatever you do, myomectomy of any variety, the pregnancy, you can allow pregnancy after 3 months of the procedure. While doing the surgical procedure like myomectomy, you have to plan it, you have to map it by MRI, you have to take care of hemostasis, you have to counsel the patient about morcellation. What you have to do is controlled, contained morcellation, that is in-bag morcellation. You have to correct the anemia, and then you have to put an interseed, that is a device by which the adhesions can be prevented. So these are the few points which I wanted to highlight for leiomyoma. Now for the today's topic of discussion is endometrial hyperplasia. So how do you define endometrial hyperplasia? Endometrial hyperplasia is the irregular proliferation of endometrial glands. We have seen that of the uterus, the lining, the above is the perimetrium or the serosa, in between is the myometrium, and the inner lining, the cavitary lining, is the endometrium. Now this endometrium has two layers, the functional layer and the basalis layer. So whatever is happening on the endometrium, it is the and the endometrium has both glands and stroma. So when there is a proliferation of endometrial glands, so that there is a glandular crowding, or you can say that there is an increase in the gland to stroma ratio, that is more number of glands and less amount of stroma, that condition is called as endometrial hyperplasia. And it has to be compared with the normal proliferative phase endometrium, that is in the first 14 days endometrium. Now what do you know about the term hyperplasia? Anything when we describe as hyperplasia means overgrowth. And when you use the term neoplasia, it means new growth or uncontrolled growth. So the two have a difference. This is hyperplasia is overgrowth. You can have a simile of say that you have estrogen and progesterone, and then you give estrogen, you keep on giving estrogen to the patient, time and again you keep on giving estrogen. So it is acting as a fertilizer for that lawn. And what will happen? It would continue to grow. It will continue to grow till you give progesterone, which has been likened to a lawnmower. So when progesterone comes into, you can cut the lawn. So when you're giving the fertilizer, you keep on giving the fertilizer, you keep on giving the estrogen, lots of estrogen, so it would grow, so it would proliferate. And when you put a progesterone, which acts as a lawnmower, then you can cut it. So there is a, whatever is happening is endometrial hyperplasia is the overgrowth which is occurring, and it is because of the uncontrolled estrogen and unopposed by progesterone. So hyperplasia, if left prolonged enough, could progress into, why are we discussing hyperplasia? Because if it is left for few years, then it can transit into cancer. So hyperplasia can be divided into two parts, with atypia and without atypia. When we use the term hyperplasia, we are talking about glands. That is, there is glandular crowding. That is more number of glands in comparison to stroma. That is hyperplasia. When we are talking about atypia, what we are talking about is the individual cell within the gland. And the individual cell, what are the characteristics of the nucleus of these glands? We are talking about atypia. So it can be simple glandular crowding without atypia, or it can be glandular crowding with atypical changes of nucleus, which would go closer to malignancy. So this is the difference between hyperplasia and neoplasia, what is the difference between atypia and tpia, and what is the difference between estrogen and progesterone. Moving further, what is the scope and epidemiology? So when we are taking this endometrium, it can proliferate into endometrial cancer, and that is why we are discussing endometrial hyperplasia. So it is a precursor to endometrial carcinoma, which is the commonest cancer in Western world in gynec malignancy part. The incidence of endometrial hyperplasia is estimated to be at least 3 times higher than the endometrial cancer. So you would get more number of cases of endometrial hyperplasia, and 1/3 of which would convert into endometrial cancer if not treated in time. So this can progress into cancer. Now, endometrial hyperplasia and endometrial carcinoma, both of them are estrogen dependent. And long-term unapproached estrogen, particularly at the perimenopause or menopause, is the main culprit, which is unopposed by progesterone, and therefore it causes proliferative glandular epithelial changes, proliferative changes, because in the proliferative phase of the cycle, it is the estrogen which takes part, and when the ovulation occurs, the progesterone comes into play. So this is a proliferative changes, just like a fertilizer, which is causing more growth of the lawn. So, and glandular, because the glands which are affected, and so glands increase, and the stroma is therefore relatively less, including glandular remodeling resulting in variably shaped, irregularly distributed glands. What is the risk? That if untreated, in the next 2 to 8 years, the significant number of them will develop into invasive carcinoma, endometrial carcinoma, out of which they can develop into adenomatous hyperplasia, atypical hyperplasia, and carcinoma in situ. So what could be the etiology? The primary factor is unopposed estrogen. The constant factor is premenopausal persistent anovulation, because we have seen that at the age of menopause, most of the cycles become anovulatory. So there is a estrogen factor is increased. What is the risk factor? Anything with a postmenopausal woman with obesity, because you have an added estrogen because of the peripheral conversion of androgen into the estrogen in these females. What is the predisposing factor? Long-term estrogen stimulation, like in PCOD and feminizing ovarian tumors. And of course, there would be multiple risk factors we will be seeing. We discussed this, that the estrogen, you can liken it to fertilizer, and progesterone, you can liken it to lawnmower. So when you give fertilizers, there is a growth of lawn, and when you put a lawnmower like progesterone, then you cut the lawn. So this is the, and therefore normally you keep it in a balance. So coming to the risk factors. Now for the risk factor of endometrial cancer, you remember it by the word cold nut. By cold nut, the C stands for cancer. The cancer is ovarian, breast and colon. O stands for obesity, then late menopause and diabetes. And for nut, you have nulliparity, unopposed progesterone, estrogen, that is in PCOS, anovulation and HRT, and tamoxifen chronic use. So these factors are also same for the endometrial hyperplasia or for the precancerous condition. So unopposed estrogen stimulation with a early menarche and late menopause, that is more estrogen exposure, polycystic ovarian syndrome, that is which comes under anovulation, diabetes, obesity and hypertension, we will learn in endometrial carcinoma, that is called as corpus cancer syndrome. Then nulliparous, that also shows you that that nulliparous or low parity is more estrogen exposure, previous radiation therapy or tamoxifen therapy, and family history of endometrial carcinoma or breast or ovary, we will see that is also a syndrome. And so age wise, what is the normal age? The common age is 50 to 54 years, that is perimenopausal or menopausal age is the age for endometrial hyperplasia. And average age is 52, which is 9 years younger, lower than the average age of cancer. the average age of endometrial cancer is about 60. So you would see that it about, if untreated, it takes about 8 years for an endometrial hyperplasia to become endometrial cancer. And what about BMI? You have to classify on the BMI by as per charts, and it is seen that the BMI of more than 30 is the becomes a predisposing factor, because more of the androgen is secreted into the estrogen. The persistent stimulation of endometrium with unopposed estrogen is the single most important factor for endometrial cancer. Of course, the median age for cancer is 60, and for precancer would be 52. And late menopause, because it is overexposure, and this is a picture of anovulation or polycystic ovary where there is no ovulation, so there is no progesterone. And of course, postmenopausal bleeding. What about, these are similar in cases of endometrial carcinoma also, what is called as corpus cancer syndrome, where there is obesity, hypertension and diabetes mellitus. So these have got a predisposing for cancer, and therefore they are considered under precancerous risk factors. Of course, we take nulliparity or unmarried, nulliparity or low parity. Then we take obesity into consideration, because of the BMI, if raised, then high free estradiol is present, which is not bound, and therefore there is an unopposed estrogen present. Family history of three types of cancer: colonic cancer, breast cancer and ovarian cancer. They predispose to endometrial cancer, and therefore pre-endometrial hyperplasia also, and therefore they can become cancerous. Opposite of which, what would be the protective factor? Any agent or factor that lowers the level of exposure of estrogen would become protective. So multiparity, exercise or physical activity to maintain a normal weight, combined OC pills or giving progesterone for any reason, or early menopause, would protect the patients from endometrial hyperplasia and endometrial cancer. What would be the most important signs and symptoms? The most common presentation would be abnormal uterine bleeding or heavy menstrual bleeding, intermenstrual bleeding, abnormal uterine bleeding, irregular bleeding. Unscheduled bleeding on patients with hormone replacement therapy or postmenopausal bleeding can also be there. These three are in the reproductive age group. This is in the postmenopausal age group. She can present with postmenopausal bleeding, or if she is in the postmenopausal period, if she is on the HRT, still she shows an unscheduled bleeding. So these are the symptoms of endometrial hyperplasia. How to diagnose it? There is no classic symptom to diagnose a pre-malignant lesion. They can suggest that these type of bleeding can suggest to investigate, but there is no classic symptom. Constant feature, of course, you can find abnormal uterine bleeding in perimenopausal and postmenopausal bleeding in postmenopausal. Most of the time it is an accidental diagnosis when you are doing an investigation for heavy menstrual bleeding or for infertility or for polycystic ovarian syndrome. You are doing a DNC and most of the time you can find out accidentally. In these women, in the at-risk women, which we have talked about as an etiology, diagnosis is not very effective. That is, you cannot do a normal vaginal pool screening, or you can do a normal endometrial aspiration by Pipelis aspirate or endometrial sampling. These are only a guideline to diagnose. Uterine curettage you can do, and then you can do it as an OPD procedure. You take a sampling of endometrium and then you find out whether she has endometrial hyperplasia. Other ways to diagnose are transvaginal sonography, that is doing a sonography in pre and postmenopausal women. Then you can do a hysteroscopy to see if there is a endometrial hyperplasia, or there is a polyp, or there is some like lesions like myoma, which is the cause. There is insufficient evidence on the use of CT, MRI and biomarkers in cases of endometrial hyperplasia. So basically it is a diagnosis by sonography and by curettage. So what do you mean by endometrial sampling? So endometrial sampling is the diagnostic test which is frequently performed in OPD. It is used by the Pipelis tube, and it is a rapid, safe and inexpensive test. In what conditions do you do it? You can do it as a clinical workup for infertility in any patients who present with the intermenstrual heavy menstrual bleeding or abnormal uterine bleeding. You can do it as a screening procedure in patients with postmenopausal bleeding or those patients who are in HRD and then show some unscheduled bleeding. If there is a patient of endometrial tuberculosis, in these cases, which are the indications, you can use a Pipillis curate and then you can use a Vebra's aspirator or Sherman's curate, and this is the which is currently used as an OPD procedure. It is a very thin plastic cannula about 2 to 4 millimeter in diameter with a plunger within it. It is negotiated through the cervix up to the fundus, and when the plunger is withdrawn, adequate amount of endometrium is withdrawn by a suction method. This can then be subjected to histopathological examination, or you can also do a hysteroscopy in such patients. So these are the risk factors, these are the sign symptoms, and these are the methods to diagnose an endometrial hyperplasia. Now, how do you classify endometrial hyperplasia? Way back in 1994, the first classification came up by WHO, and that was based on the cytology. And that classification is no longer used now. This classification of WHO in 1994 classified this endometrial hyperplasia into four categories: a simple hyperplasia without atypia, then simple hyperplasia with atypia, then complex hyperplasia without atypia, and complex hyperplasia with atypia. So that was a simple and complex with or without atypia. That was a former classification in 1994, and it was based on cytology, how the cells look like and how the glands architecture was. Estimated risk of progression was in those with a complex with atypical, the fourth variety, was the most commonly converting it into endometrial cancer. So you could see the percentage when it was a simple hyperplasia without atypia, the conversion into endometrial carcinoma was 1%. Now when it was simple hyperplasia with atypia, the conversion was 8%. And when it was complex hyperplasia with atypia, that is the most dangerous of it, then the conversion rate of this type of endometrial hyperplasia into endometrial cancer was as high as 29 to 30%. So it classified on the basis of cytology. It used to see the glandular architecture and used to see the nuclear atypia for these four categories. And when there was glandular complexity, that is glandular crowding, back-to-back glands, then it became hyperplasia. And when the nucleus shows changes, then it became atypia. Then came in 2003 the EIN classification. Like we have CIN in cancer cervix, they proposed it as EIN. This is also not used. So EIN, that is endometrial intraepithelial neoplasia diagnostic procedure, was made by collaboration of the various societies. And what they divided it? They divided into benign, that pathologic criteria, benign endometrial EIN, then pre-malignant, that is which was called as endometrial intraepithelial neoplasia, and then it was adenocarcinoma or the malignant. So depending upon the grading, it was either benign or malignant, and the pre-malignant was called as EIN. And therefore it has a prognostic significance. But this was also not very acceptable. Then this is the revised classification of 2014, which we are now recommending. So this divides it only into two categories. It simply separates endometrial hyperplasia into two groups: a benign hyperplasia, that is it has doesn't have atypia, and then atypical hyperplasia. So it has only two, that is with a benign, maybe simple, maybe complex, but without atypia. And then atypical hyperplasia may be simple or complex, but it is atypical. So based on the presence or absence of the nuclei, they divided into without atypia and with atypia. So it was called as benign hyperplasia without atypia and atypical hyperplasia, which is on the complexity of architecture, is no longer taken into classification. It is only the atypia which is taken. The glandular part was left behind. So this is the revised WHO classification which is followed today, or which is recommended as on today. Now, for all these times, we were talking about simple, complex, without ATPR, with ATPR. So, what does it mean? You all have passed through the pathology, and this would be very much easier for you to understand that these are the slide pictures where the endometrium is simple hyperplasia, means endometrium is thick, that is one, the thickness. Then the glands are dilated with outpouching and invagination, that you can see, and there is a crowding of glands with irregular outline. There is increased of gland to stroma ratio with more number of glands and less amount of stroma. More or less in the simple type, it is more or less like a proliferative endometrium, although the stroma is is more dense, that is, the stroma is more glandular. When it comes to complexity of hyperplasia, the endometrium still gets thicker, the glands still get crowded, they you can see they are arranged back to back, there is very less amount of stroma in between, and most of the glands have lost their shape, they become irregular, and there is a papillary projections inside the glands or intraluminal bridges we can be seen, and these are the pseudo stratifications. When we come to atypical, so this is the we divided in the 2014 classification, that is, it is a simple hyperplasia. You can see the nuclei are all normal without ATPR, and you can see the atypical hyperplasia where there are changes. What are the changes? The changes are there in the nucleoli, that is, they are enlarged nucleus, irregular in size and shape, hyperchromatic nucleus and coarse chromatin, thickened nuclear membrane and prominent nucleoli, which are the signs and symptoms of ATPR. So, this is what we are, atypical hyperplasia of 2014 classification. So, this is the simple hyperplasia, this is the complex hyperplasia, and this is the atypical hyperplasia. And then comes the carcinoma in situ, which is the severe architectural abnormality of glands. Now, there is another etiology which has been said, is that about the clonicity. The polyclonal lesions are regarded as responsible for abnormal hormonal environment. That is why we designate the term hyperplasia. And monoclonal lesions are associated with increased risk of projection to carcinoma, and therefore they called it as endometrial intraepithelial neoplasia. So this was the theory of carcinogenesis. They said that it is localized, then it becomes pre-malignant, and then it becomes malignant. That is, the some of the cells, normal cells, they have a fraction of mutant endometrial glands. They undergo mutation, and therefore these mutations lead to EIN. That was the theory. So the nomenclature was given, and it was seen that which we called as risk factors now, in these cases the changes are such that they crosses the phase of endometrial intraepithelial neoplasia, and then they cross into carcinoma. So these are the unopposed estrogen effects on the endometrial glands. You see that this is the proliferative endometrium, and then this endometrium shows more of the glands, it shows still more glands, and then it becomes benign endometrial hyperplasia, that is bulky endometrium. So endometrial hyperplasia or EIN was a pre-malignant condition. It was precursor to endometrial carcinoma. It was divided into grades, which we called as simple and complex. That was the EIN category, and it was based on architecture, that is more glands compared to stroma. Cytology we called as atypical, the sizes, the thickness of it, and then you have to rule out, we will see what you have to rule out when you are seeing the histology of these. So you have to rule out the other artifacts and polyps, you have to exclude the cancer to call it as hyperplasia. So on one side it is not pure cancer, on other side you have to see to the conditions which are not hyperplasia, like polyp or repair or basalis or secretory endometrium. So you take it an example of tiles. So when you see our architectural feature, see the difference. Their tiles are placed so evenly and so closely together. So this is called as the, so consider this as stroma, and this consider this as gland. So there is a glandular crowding where there is a stroma and epithelium and glandular lumen. Three things are taken into consideration. So each gland would have a big glandular lumen, and this is the benign to malignant change. Now what you have to exclude, one side you have to exclude pure cancer and other side you have to exclude the reactive changes like infection or recent pregnancy. In those cases also you would get a similar picture, you will be mistaken for endometrial hyperplasia. And then some of the artifacts also would look like this, and then you can mistaken it as an endometrial hyperplasia. So that also you have to exclude from the carcinoma when you diagnose or label it as endometrial hyperplasia. Another thing is that when there is a loss of estrogen, it leads to breakdown of the endometrial glands. And this breakdown also gives you like a picture, cytology picture, which is unsupported by stroma. This also gives you a picture of endometrial hyperplasia. You have to be careful in reporting it as an endometrial hyperplasia. And of course, endometrial polyps, the focal lesions, may sometimes give you a picture, when infected, may give you a picture of endometrial hyperplasia. So these are few differential diagnoses which you have to keep in mind. Now coming to the management part, which is the most important part when we are discussing endometrial hyperplasia. So for any, like any other disease, the first would be to prevent it. So how do you prevent it? You ask the patient to maintain her body weight, maintain her BMI. Whatever the source of estrogen she is using, you can stop that estrogen, you can combine oral contraceptive to her if she is taking unopposed estrogen, and then you can do her periodic endometrial sampling. You can do that to prevent the endometrial hyperplasia. Now what about definitive treatment? So this is the prevention part. Now in the management part, what is the definitive treatment? The definitive treatment would depend upon whether she is premenopausal or young reproductive age woman with presenting with abnormal uterine bleeding, or she is a postmenopausal woman. And of course the treatment would depend upon whether it is be divided under WHO classification is benign without atypia or atypical hyperplasia. So it would depend upon her age and it would depend upon her type. Age is premenopausal, menopausal. Type is without atypia, with atypia. So young woman without atypia, cystic adenomatous hyperplasia, what you do is that everything is not normal, but there are signs of hyperplasia, but the hyperplasia is simple one, that is there is no atypia. Then put her on cyclic progesterone therapy for 3 to 6 months, followed by endometrial sampling. So here we put her on medical treatment, which is the progesterone we are giving. We are giving it for 6 months, and after 6 months we are doing an endometrial sampling to see whether it is still hyperplasia without atypia or it has progressed to atypical hyperplasia. If the patient is of a polycystic ovarian syndrome, you start giving her induction of ovulation. So you put her on drugs so that her anovulation part is corrected. If there is an atypical hyperplasia, if she is young, but it is not the simple type of hyperplasia, but she is young with an atypical hyperplasia, then you can still give her progesterone for 6 to 9 months. But in this case, the follow-up has to be more rigorous, and then you have to also counsel her for hysterectomy. Coming to perimenopausal or postmenopausal with or without atypia. With or without atypia, the ideal would be hysterectomy. But still, in cases of postmenopausal or perimenopausal without atypia, you can still consider progesterone. But here the progesterone would be continuous. There would be no cyclical progesterone. And seeing to her age, seeing to her atypical feature of hyperplasia, you have to advise her that she can have cancer with age, and therefore the recommended treatment would be total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. And with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy, we will know why. Then moderate to severe atypical hyperplasia, there is nothing doing, you have only to do hysterectomy. So postmenopausal or perimenopausal with a atypical hyperplasia, straight away you have to advise her hysterectomy. Without atypia, you can give progesterone for some time, but ideal would be, in spite of sampling, you may miss, and then ideal would be hysterectomy. Now taking it one by one. endometrial hypoplasia without ATPS. So now we are following the WHO 2014 classification, endometrial hypoplasia without ATPS. So now, first of all, you consider a counseling to the patient. First of all, inform her that in few years of time, she might develop endometrial cancer even if this hyperplasia shows no atypical changes in the cells. And therefore, the chances would be though less than 5%, and though it would take 20 years, but the chances are still there. That you have to counsel. Majority of them without ATPR will regress if they have a good follow-up. You have to tell her that also. So you have to tell her the importance of follow-up. Then reversible risk factors has to be identified, like those with obesity, ask her to decrease her weight. If there is PCOS, give her ovulatory drugs. If she is on pure estrogen, try to give her combined OC. So whatever risk factors which are reversible, try to reverse that by the time you are giving progesterone therapy. That is, you treat obesity, use HRT, you do observation alone in these patients. And what do you do for follow-up? You do endometrial biopsy to ensure that the disease has either regressed or not progressed. Inform that progesterone, and if she is not ready to do anything, you are not ready to do hysterectomy, not ready to take progesterone, this is the counseling you have to do. That is, reversible risk factors, treat obesity and PCOS, and treat unopposed estrogen, and just follow. And counsel her that she can always develop cancer, though less. But best would be in such cases also that if she is in this picture, it is best that we start medical therapy, that is progesterone, and therefore it may correct in some cases, and therefore it can cause regression when we do for follow-up. So that is a medical therapy has to be given in endometrial hypoplasia without ATPR. Now, what is the indication for medical therapy? Straight away, the patients with endometrial hyperplasia without ATPR, that is one. Second, those who have been only following it up but who fail to regress following this, when you do a second endometrial biopsy, you see that the picture is same, then anyhow you have to start medical treatment. She becomes symptomatic in the meantime, that is a postmenopausal woman or a perimenopausal woman starts bleeding, then you have to start progesterone. And the type of progesterone which you have to give is a continuous progesterone, which can be oral, which can be injectable, and there comes the place of LNG-IUS again. LNG-IUS is a great friend of our obstetricians and gynecologists, and therefore LNG-IUS is the first line of treatment in such cases of endometrial hyperplasia without ATPR. That is why I have put it in bold. As progesterone therapy is going directly to the lining of the uterus, it is when you are giving oral drugs, it has to have a first bypass effect, it has to go to all the progesterone receptors all over the body, but here the LNG-IUS is acting directly at the where it should, that is at the site of endometrium, and the regression rate is good. It is favorable, the bleeding profile corrects, there are fewer side effects when you are giving it directly, continuous low-dose progesterone is provided, and if she is not accepting LNG-IUS, then the other drug of choice is medroxyprogesterone acetate 10 mg per day continuously, or norethisterone 10 mg per day. This is the second line of treatment for cases of endometrial hyperplasia without ATPR. Cyclical progesterone should not be used. Cyclical means 21 days, then 5 days gap, or 10 days and then gap. That should not be used. It is less effective for regression. And what should be the duration of treatment? The duration of treatment should be minimum 6 months. So the treatment, even if you have put a 5-year LNG-IUS, the minimum should be, or you are giving a continuous oral progesterone, the minimum should be 6 months. In order to induce the histological regression changes in endometrial hyperplasia without ATPR, it requires 6 months of continuous progesterone. Then what you do is, then after 6 months you take an endometrial biopsy. If fertility is not desired, ask her, counsel her to retain this LNG-IUS for 5 years. And in this case, the indication for LNG-IUS changes. It can be given even up to 7 years it worked. The same LNGIUS where we in contraception we say that it works for 5 years. In cases of endometrial hyperplasia we say that that it works for 7 years. But nevertheless you should counsel her for 5 years. The guideline says 5 years. Reduce risk of relapse, AUB has to be treated in this case. You repeat endometrial biopsy, which is an outpatient procedure, after 6 months. And see that this is called as endometrial surveillance, which is arranged at 6 months. And then you see the type of hyperplasia. If you have 2 consecutive 6 months biopsies as negative, that is no hyperplasia, then you counsel that the patient is called as negative. So when you are giving progesterone, you give it for 6 months, take an endometrial biopsy, it shows a negative endometrial hyperplasia, again give progesterone for 6 months, it shows a negative biopsy, then only you say that after 1 year of course, she is free from endometrial hyperplasia, so now she is within the range of normal patient. Women with risk of factors like BMI more than 35 or have a risk of relapse, then the risk of 6 monthly biopsy can also be taken as 3 months. 6 monthly biopsy is mandatory. It is that that the patient who has got a endometrial hyperplasia but it is without ATPR, but she has a BMI, she is obese, then also there is a risk of endometrial cancer. So another risk factor that is added apart from ATPR, which is without ATPR, then also you recommend endometrial biopsy. And once 2 consecutive biopsies are negative, then you ask her to come annually or for annual endometrial biopsy. Then we come to second type, that is endometrial hyperplasia with ATPR. Now this has to be divided under 2. She has ATPR, but she is young and she desires fertility. And then without ATPR, with ATPR, she has no desire for fertility. That is 2. So the atypical endometrial hyperplasia is there, atypical changes are there, but the patient desires fertility and she doesn't desire fertility. For those with this scene, that is hyperplasia with ATPR, with the family completed, the only and only treatment is surgical. There is no role of medical. What is the surgery you are planning? Abdominal hysterectomy should be done with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. What is the approach you are taking? You can take a laparoscopic approach or you can take an abdominal approach. Laparoscopic, you can prefer it. There is no benefit that you take a frozen section at the time of doing surgery. There is no, as in cases of carcinoma, what you do is that you take a frozen section and then you decide ki what should be the extent of your surgery. But in this case, you are very sure in hyperplasia with ATPR, you don't want to do lymphadenectomy. So you don't want to do a frozen section. You only have to do abdominal hysterectomy, TAH, with BSO. For premenopausal with ATPR, and there is a chance that she may request fertility later, then you have to counsel her and you have to see that what to do with BSO. Then you have to counsel her that if you leave the ovaries behind, there may be chances of ovarian malignancy because she comes under that risk category of pre-malignance with ovarian malignancy. So she can, if you leave the ovary behind, in cases of she is doing her TAH in a premenopausal age group, then in that case you can counsel her and tell her that it is a ovarian malignancy which has to be followed up. There is no role of endometrial ablation because you are likely to miss. So this is the treatment of choice in endometrial hyperplasia with ATPR, with menopause and without menopause. With menopause, TH with BSO, perimenopause, TH with BSO, young reproductive age group, endometrial hyperplasia with ATPR, with ATPR, TH with or without BSO. But when endometrial hyperplasia with ATPR, young who desires fertility, those wishing for fertility for unsuitable for surgery, then you should be counseled about the risk of undergoing malignancy, underlying malignancy in 2 to 5 years or 2 to 8 years down the line. If she is not in follow-up, she might develop endometrial cancer. and subsequent progression to endometrial cancer is always to be kept in mind. Pre-treatment investigation should aim to rule out invasive endometrial cancer or coexisting ovarian cancer in such cases. In such cases, there is atypical changes, there is hyperplasia, but she desires fertility, then the first line changes to not surgery but LNG-IUS. And then second line is oral progestogens. Once she completes her fertility, no longer requirement, immediately switch on to hysterectomy, which is with ATPI is the treatment of choice. You have to follow up even if she is asymptomatic. That is a rule. That is, it is not that she has to have an abnormal uterine bleeding or irregular menstrual bleeding. A postmenopausal patient with an atypical symptoms, atypical hyperplasia, you have to have a endometrial biopsy. Now the timing changes. For endometrial hyperplasia without ATPI, you are doing endometrial biopsy every 6 months. In cases of endometrial hyperplasia with ATPI, you want a more frequent follow-up. So you are doing an endometrial biopsy every 3 months if she is a patient of desirous of fertility. Now you repeat it after 3 months. And then if there are two consecutive biopsies which are negative, then you allow her to become pregnant. That is, you allow her fertility. So if she is on biopsy, comes endometrial hyperplasia with ATPI, you do you start her on LNG-IUS even for 6 months, or you start her on oral progesterone, then you take a biopsy, then you subject it to histopathological examination, it has come out to be negative, then continue with the same treatment for another 3 months, it again comes out to be negative, then you remove your LNG or stop your progesterone, allow her fertility. Once she has completed a family, do a hysterectomy. Now what about endometrial hyperplasia and fertility management? Disease regression should be achieved at least one endometrial sample before you allow her to conceive. The ideal would be two samples, but at least one endometrial sample should be coming out as negative to allow her to conceive. What about natural conception and assisted reproduction? Of course, assisted reproduction and IVF have a better chance because the chances are higher and may prevent relapse compared to attempts through natural conception. Regression of endometrial hyperplasia should be achieved before ART that we discussed. And chance of higher inflammation, implantation and clinical pregnancy rates are higher if you use an assisted reproduction. What about patients with endometrial hyperplasia who are on HRT? A woman who has her uterus and systemic estrogen alone is given for HRT, then it should be stopped. If she is using HRT, she should use combined estrogen and progesterone, even if she has a uterus within, and then you have to give estrogen and progesterone in such cases with the ATPI. All taking HRT should be encouraged to report any unscheduled vaginal bleeding promptly because they may be a symptom of endometrial hyperplasia. The woman on sequential HRT wishing to continue HRT should be encouraged to shift to continuous combined HRT preparation, that is combined estrogen and progesterone, and that too continuous, or they should be shifted to LNG-IUS, that is for those with HRT. Now, women with endometrial hyperplasia taking tamoxifen. They are taking at the same time an adjuvant treatment for breast cancer. So, those taking tamoxifen should be informed that there is an increased risk of endometrial hyperplasia and cancer, although they are taking treatment for breast cancer. So, she can develop endometrial cancer. Encouraged to report any abnormal vaginal bleeding or discharge promptly. Drug like aromatase inhibitors like anastrozole, letrozole, these medications are not known to increase the risk of endometrial hyperplasia and cancer. Evidence suggests that LNG-IUS is the treatment of choice even in women, those with tamoxifen, and they should be confined to complete. If they are on tamoxifen, the endometrial hyperplasia is there, then you can always say about hysterectomy. Routine endometrial biopsy, the treatment and subject to histopathological examination remains the same. So what we learned is that TAH is the treatment of choice of endometrial hyperplasia. It is the definitive treatment. It should be done with BSO. If you are not removing the ovaries, you should counsel that she can have ovarian cancer. The unacceptable treatment for this is that you cannot leave the cervix behind. You cannot do a subtotal hysterectomy or supracervical hysterectomy. There is no role of morcellation like in fibroids. There is no role of ablation like in other AUB treatment. Systemic and local progesterones are unproven but commonly used. They have no role as such, the progesterone, but they are used, that is the oral ones, and the treatment of choice in those cases are only for poor surgical candidates or those who desire fertility, and that too LNG IUS. So coming to the last two or three slides, this is the classification which we are following. WHO classification 2014, hyperplasia without ATPR, atypical hyperplasia, chance of developing into cancer is less than 1 without ATPR, is as high as 30%, 29 to 30% where there is atypical hyperplasia. That is the simple classification by WHO by 2014. What about the algorithm? When we will be studying endometrial malignancy, we would be again repeating this algorithm. But what as of now, we will be concentrating our knowledge to about endometrial hyperplasia alone, which is coming under the classification of AUBM in the cases of a palm coin classification. So endometrial malignancy, the standard protocol of management of malignancy we would be following. But as of now, we are reading endometrial hyperplasia, that is AUBM, then it would depend upon without ATPR or with ATPR. The one shown in the green zone, that is hyperplasia without ATPR, you give an LNG IUS as the first line of therapy for this. Just follow up after the with endometrial biopsy in cases and see if she is not accepting LNG IUS, give her oral progesterone and just follow up. If she is all right, then you can just say that preventive hysterectomy should be considered or accepted if she has completed her fertility and it is without ATPR but hyperplasia persists. Then, and of course, encourage her to decrease her obesity and prospects of weight loss. This is where without ATPR. Now, when there are endometrial hyperplasia with atypical changes, the only and only treatment of choice is hysterectomy or definitive treatment. And conservative treatment with high dose of progesterone and histological monitoring should be considered in exceptional cases where she wants her fertility. So recommendations in these cases are endometrial hyperplasia with ATPR. The repeated cases of is minimum 6 months. Close monitoring should be done. Best would be if you do it 3 monthly. And ablation has got no role because it destroys completely the endometrium and therefore it has no endometrium left for histological follow-up. So this is the last flow chart which I want to share with you. This is endometrial hyperplasia which is less than 40 years of age. Fertility preservation is wanted if it is atypical and if it is without ATPR. Without ATPR, you are giving progesterone, that is medroxyprogesterone acetate 10 to 20 milligram and follow up after 3 to 6 months and then pregnancy. And then you can diagnose, you can take a decision criteria and then you can treat. If it is atypical hyperplasia, you can still give this progesterone, but hysterectomy is the, and then you can give LNG IUS, you can do hysteroscopy, you can do curettage, you can follow up after every 3 months. And then after two consecutive treatment negative biopsies, you can then shift her to hysterectomy. So, and the endometrial cancer part we will be studying when we are studying the endometrial cancer. So thank you very much. We are planning a first internal assessment as I have shared with you, and this would be the last class of May. Then you would have a preparation leave, and then you will have a, and then you would have your in Ops Gynae. It is on 10th of June, The pattern would be similar as we had one exam on 11th of May. You would be having 60 questions of multiple choice, and only one of it would be correct, and there would be no negative marking as of now. But maybe let me discuss it with the other departments, and if they have, yesterday there were queries about auto submission, about the timer, about negative marking. So let me discuss it with all, and then we will let you know. By that time, everyone will give you the syllabus on which the multiple choice question of OBS-Gyne would be made of. So thank you very much for patient hearing.